Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The next item of business is a debate without motion on the subject of accessing Scottish Social Security benefits. And I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Shona Robison to open the debate. Up to 12 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to open this debate on accessing Scottish Social Security benefits. Access to Social Security is a basic human right and a principle enshrined in our 2018 Social Security Act, as is the view that Social Security is an investment in people. And within that Act is the important duty of ensuring the Government promote the take-up of Scottish benefits. And that's why the Scottish Government is clear that we'll ensure that anyone eligible for a range of benefits can access them simply and easily, and that we actively work to promote the financial support available to people. And this debate comes after the publication of our second benefit take-up strategy, published at the end of October. And as the nation focuses on recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic, we are also, of course, seeing households face increased living costs and an imminent rise in national insurance. So it's more important than ever that people entitled to our benefits know about them, apply for them, and get the financial support that they are eligible for. Yes.
Willie Rennie.
I thank the Minister, and also for the publication of the new strategy that was sent to us this morning by the Minister, which was helpful. But can the Minister tell us what she's learned since 2016 about how long it takes to implement new Social Security benefits? Because we did expect it to happen much earlier than this, because it was promised by the Minister that it would happen almost instantly. So why has it taken 5 years to even to get to this stage?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, actually, a lot has been achieved in the 3 years since this Parliament agreed the powers to be able to establish Social Security Scotland and establish the benefits. So 11 benefits, seven of which are brand new to Scotland, I think is actually a very good record for Social Security Scotland in the 3 years since it's been able to build its capacity and deliver these benefits. And hopefully that's something the member will take on board. And if he hasn't already done so, I would encourage him to visit Social Security Scotland to find out for himself some of the complexity involved in setting up some of the benefits, particularly the new benefits. Yes.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you for taking the intervention, Cabinet Secretary, particularly so closely to answering the previous one. I did have the benefit of meeting Social Security Scotland earlier on in the week with the Social Security Committee, and I found it really, really, really helpful. But one of the things that was clear, and they said a few times in the presentation, was that their role is on delivery of the benefits that they have. So they're focusing just now on, as you'll know, the Scottish Child Payment and others, but that the government's role is on policy and direction around that. So given the separation of those responsibilities in that sense, as separate as they can be, could the government not be moving on policies around eligibility criteria and adequacy of payments quickly in tandem with Social Security Scotland, who are clear that there is a separate duty in terms of delivery?
Well, both are important and both have to work in tandem. I mean, that's why the First Minister, on her visit to the agency headquarters in Dundee, announced the massive expansion of Social Security Scotland because of the disability benefits that will be coming over the next year to 18 months, and the build-up of capacity of that organisation is why that expansion is happening. So the two are in tandem. And we will always, of course, look at what more we can do. We're already looking at the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment, as the member knows, and we'll be setting out more plans for that as part of the budget process. I want to make a bit of progress, if that's okay. Increasing Social Security and income maximisation are important components of our work to tackle poverty. Our Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan sets out that increasing incomes through social security and benefits in kind is one of the key drivers of reducing child poverty. Taken together with action to increase incomes from work and earnings and to reduce household costs, this will help to lift families out of poverty and provide the financial security families need to thrive. And whilst we've seen the reduction in UK government reserve benefits over the past decade take its toll on people and reduce their income, that is not the approach that this government is taking. And in the last 3 years, since we had the powers to do so, we've introduced a raft of benefits to support the people of Scotland. As I said earlier, our agency, Social Security Scotland, is now delivering 11 benefits, 7 of them brand new and unique in the UK. We'll also continue to deliver through our local authority partners, the Scottish Welfare Fund, discretionary housing payments, including mitigating in full the bedroom tax and council tax reduction. And despite the challenges over the last year and a half due to the pandemic and the obvious impact this has had on our timetable for delivery of Scottish benefits, over the last year we introduced 4 new benefits despite those challenges, and I think that's a pretty good record. In addition to this range of continuing support, we have introduced specific one-off payments to support people during these very difficult times. This includes paying around 90,000 unpaid carers, an additional £230 carers allowance supplement last year and this year. We introduced bridging payments for families in receipt of free school meals so that they're receiving the equivalent of the Scottish Child Payment. £520 is being paid this year and next to support around 150,000 children and young people in advance of the Scottish Child Payment being rolled out to under 16s. Very briefly,
Miles Briggs.
Secretary, the committee has heard concerns around Young Carers Grant and people applying for that. Is that something which the government's looked into, as take-up hasn't been as expected?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, so the Minister for Social Security promoted it last week as part of, I think it was a 2-year anniversary. So there's always opportunities to promote, and this is why we're having this debate, really to get that message across that people should apply, that they're entitled to these supports. We also delivered a low-income pandemic payment of £130 to everyone who received council tax reduction in April. Around 500,000 households benefited from that payment by the end of last month. So these payments demonstrate that we're using the powers available to us to put cash directly in the pockets of those who need it most. And I want to thank our local authorities for the role they play in supporting us in that. Delivery is vital in accessing benefits, and I'm very proud of the central role that Scotland's newest public service agency, Social Security Scotland, also plays in this. The agency is fundamental to ensuring that every person requiring access to that assistance is empowered and fully supported to do so. In the last financial year, Social Security Scotland invested around £430,000 marketing the 10 benefits available at that time, and we know this is making a difference. As an example, Facebook advertising alone helped to drive more than 50,000 applications last year. Inclusive communications is at the heart of Social Security Scotland's approach. And we also ensure that information is available offline for all campaigns so that information is accessible to everyone in a way that suits them best. We know that in the past, access to Social Security has not always been straightforward. And even now, for some UK benefits, we know that there are complexities and hurdles that make the benefits system challenging to navigate for many. Indeed, we know from the previous committee sessions on the subject that the UK system is not backed by any plan or strategy to promote the take-up of Social Security, such as we have here in Scotland. In October last year, the then Cabinet Secretary for Social Security and Older People joined with the Welsh and Northern Irish counterparts in writing to the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions to urge a more strategic approach to maximising the take-up of reserved benefits. But to date, unfortunately, no response has been received. Our 2021 benefit take-up strategy sets out the Scottish Government's approach to maximising the take-up of Scottish benefits, as well as providing our best estimates of the take-up of the benefits currently being delivered. Acknowledging that Social Security must be part of a more holistic approach to income maximisation in order to support recovery from COVID, the strategy is built around 5 key principles developed through extensive stakeholder engagement and experience panel research. Firstly, we will prioritise person-centred approaches We recognise that one size doesn't fit all and that we need to adapt and deliver tailored approaches. Secondly, we will communicate and engage effectively, sending out the right messages at the right time in the right place for the target audience. Thirdly, we'll bring services to people, simplifying processes and ensuring that we bring advice and support services to people where they need it, rather than expecting people to always come to us. And fourthly, is that we'll encourage cross-system collaboration, making sure that other public sector and third sector organisations help to deliver that. And finally, we will continuously learn and improve, building on the evidence that we know and taking that on board to do things differently if required. So each of these five principles taken alone are important, and bringing them together into the 2021 strategy means that they'll work in combination and yield far greater impact. Inclusivity is at the centre of the system of social security that we're building and is fundamental to our approach to promoting the take-up of benefits. And we know that there are many barriers preventing that take-up and that these vary across different segments of the population. Our commitment to engaging with seldom heard groups and those representing protected characteristics is driving new and bespoke approaches to supporting people to access assistance. In January, we'll launch our Social Security Advocacy Service, which the Scottish Government has invested up to £20.4 million in, which will be delivered independently of the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland. And that service will mean that anyone identifying as having a disability and requiring help to communicate will have free access to the support they need to participate fully in social security processes and decisions which affect them. We're also investing £10 million over the current Parliament to increase access to advice and accessible settings to maximise incomes and tackle poverty. And this includes expanding welfare advice and health partnerships through the funding of £2.9 million over 3 years to place welfare rights advisers in up to 150 GP surgeries across Scotland's most deprived areas. We'll also look at opportunities to extend that model in education settings, because there's good evidence that placing advice in these trusted settings is a powerful tool for getting information to people who need it in the right place at the right time. And we know for many, the need to access benefits can be overshadowed by a fear of being stigmatised. And we want to change that by challenging that discourse, empowering people to recognise their rights and access the benefits that they're entitled to. And to do this, we're working alongside stakeholders, engaging with those with lived experience. And later this month, we'll be launching a marketing campaign focused on financial well-being, beginning with a focus on removing the stigma around benefits. Our primary audience will be those people who have been impacted by the COVID-19 pandemic and are struggling financially as a result. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, the Scottish Government is committed to building a robust and accessible Scottish social security system, and we're investing in supporting access to social security, and we're committing substantial resources to develop and implement our strategy. I look forward to hearing what others have to say in this debate this afternoon.
Thank you. Thank you. Members may wish to be aware that we do have time in hand this afternoon for interventions, and time will be given back wherever possible. And could I just ask again if any member wishing to contribute this afternoon could please make sure they've pressed their request to speak button, and I call Miles Briggs.
Officer, and I literally just pressed the button, so I apologise. But I very much welcome today's debate on accessing Scottish Social Security benefits and the ongoing discussions across this Parliament around the priorities around reforms which are needed. And I was pleased, as Pam Duncan-Glancy has already said, to visit Social Security Scotland on Monday of this week alongside fellow members of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. And I'd like to thank those who are working in the organisation for that very helpful visit and the work which they have been undertaking to date to help establish the organisation. Despite the pandemic, as the Cabinet Secretary has said, it's clear that Social Security Scotland and the DWP are working in close partnership to help build the systems in Scotland that can help develop a new institutional knowledge and indeed to help deliver a successful benefit system that Scotland requires. And I'd like to thank those organisations as well who have provided useful briefings ahead of today's debate. The 2016 Scotland Act introduced sweeping devolution of welfare powers. Scottish ministers now have full control over 11 benefits that were previously run by the UK government. The Scottish Government are now also able to top up UK-wide reserve benefits as well as create their own suite of new benefits. Building a sustainable and responsive social security and benefits system is in all of our interests, and we on these benches want to make sure that the system the next Scottish Government will inherit as well is fit for purpose and will deliver for the people of Scotland. One area which is extremely important for this Parliament, I believe, though, to scrutinise is around the costs of setting up Social Security Scotland. It's estimated that the costs now stand at around £651 million. Now, the SNP previously had put a cost of around £307 million 4 years ago to create the new agency and the devolved powers being delivered. But Social Security Scotland clearly is costing more, and it's something this Parliament has an important responsibility to scrutinise. Yes, I'm happy to.
Ben McPherson.
I appreciate the importance and significance of what Mr Briggs has raised and that he does so in good faith. However, I also pose the question to him to consider that, of course, Social Security Scotland is delivering more benefits than were envisaged in 2018 because of the seven new benefits that have been created, and that we are at a key point in the conception of Social Security Scotland to build that strength, not just for the years to come, but for the decades thereafter, and to make sure it's a strong institution for the people of Scotland, as Mr Briggs rightly highlighted, he wishes it to be so.
Miles Briggs.
I accept the Minister's point, but I think it's important for this Parliament and for the committee especially to be scrutinising the costs around establishing the operation, because we know, and we were told on Monday, in fact, that currently operating costs, including agency agreements with the DWP, are set around 10% of all current benefit expenditures which are going out in Scotland under the sweep of benefits the Minister's outlined. Now, I welcome the assurances which we've been given, and this is a prediction at the moment, that this will come in line with the DWP, which currently stands around 6.3% of benefit expenditure. But I think all of us in this chamber want to make sure that every single taxpayer pound is being put to payments for claimants, not administration costs. Now, the use of technology and new working can reduce these costs, and I think that's an important part of the argument we really haven't had about how we modernise our welfare system as well. I'm sure everyone across the chamber, like I've said, wants to make sure that we are seeing the money we put into welfare in Scotland in this Parliament or coming from Westminster going to claimants. An important part, though, of today's debate is looking to the future and the proposed reforms of how people will be able to access social security benefits under the new system and new models which are being outlined. The Scottish Government have already signalled that they intend to replace PIP with ADP. What is not clear, though, at this moment in time is around the new criteria and the assessment protocols in accessing this benefit. Now, SAMH state in their useful briefing that around 39% of people currently in receipt of PIP in Scotland have a mental health problem. This group of clients have faced some of the greatest challenges during the pandemic. We all know that. And SAMH research has found that applicants often find accessing processes and frequent reassessments cause additional stress. So I know all members of the committee want to know what these reforms will actually look like and what processes will be put in place for these individuals to have awards made. And certainly the organisations such that I've outlined, like SAMH and MS Society Scotland, are looking for these details ahead of any potential reforms. And I think it's important that Parliament has that opportunity to properly scrutinise those. If I've got time, I'll take both.
Yes, Minister.
I think we've got time.
Thank you, Mr Briggs. For Mr Briggs' awareness and that of Parliament, of course, he will be aware that SCOS have given their feedback and given their recommendations on the draft regulations for adult disability payment, and the government will be responding soon to that, and then of course there will be the opportunity for the committee to scrutinise the regulations when they are brought forward to Parliament.
Miles Briggs.
I absolutely agree. I think what's not clear is how the changes will be put in place, what criteria will necessarily be brought forward, and who will undertake some of the potential assessments which might also be needed. I'm happy to take the convener.
Neil Gray.
I thank Miles Briggs for giving way. I'm very much looking forward to where there may be policy and eligibility divergence from adult and child disability payment from what has come before with PIP. But would Miles Briggs reflect on some of the evidence that we've received in the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, that the Scottish Fiscal Commission projects that by making it easier for people to apply for ADP, that they predict that that additional cost to the Scottish Government will be £500 million, which needs to be found elsewhere in the Scottish budget. But that highlights how easier to access ADP will be from PIP. Would you like to reflect on what that means about what PIP is, which is a big barrier for disabled people to access support?
Miles Briggs.
Well, I agree with the member, but I think what's important is, you know, we're still early days. We don't necessarily know what uptake will look like and how payments will be necessarily easier. One of the discussions, which I do agree with the member on, is at the Social Security Committee, around the new assessments which will be potentially needed, who will undertake those, and whether or not that will, like the current system, put people off necessarily applying. And it was interesting to hear about the work already being undertaken around supportive documentation on Monday, which we had heard, because I think there is need to look towards that potential reform. We know already the challenges which exist in building an integrated system with GPs, health boards and also local authorities. It's not clear, and certainly the conversations I know we've had on this, whether or not that will be any easier under this new system. So it's clear that these public organisations I've outlined need to look towards how they become an integral part of the design and development of any new system as well. Now, in the time I have left, I wanted to touch upon the Charter as well. Section 3 of the Act, as the Cabinet Secretary has mentioned, places a duty on ministers to promote the take-up of benefits. The Act specifically specifies that ministers must publish a strategy which they intend to promote the take-up, and that ministers consult on this with individuals and organisations. Now, I know that the review has recently completed its work on that and that the thinking currently is being looked at in government, but I think it is important for the many organisations and people with lived experience that they are an integral part of what comes out of that review as well. The Social Security Scotland Charter sets out what people can expect from the Scottish Social Security system and how Social Security Scotland will uphold these principles. But I think it's important we also look towards a commitment that people's well-being will be also assessed as part of that. And so I'd be interested when, I don't know if the Minister or the Cabinet Secretary is closing today's debate, what actual evaluation has taken place of the new system to date to embed this Charter and the values, which I think we all agree on. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, today's debate is a welcome opportunity, I think, to discuss the new Social Security Scotland systems which are being put in place. And it does give all members, I hope, an opportunity to contribute to what should be a cross-party effort to establish this organisation. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I often feel that one of the things, or two of the things I say most in this chamber, is that I welcome the government's policy intentions, but that I don't feel that their actions go far enough to make them a reality. And so you'll be unsurprised to hear that today is no different in that respect. I give the government a lot of credit for recognising the importance of addressing access to social security. And the rhetoric, of course, is good. However, in my view, the solutions that's been set out to address access to social security won't go far enough to do what the government wants to deliver. As many members will know, I don't think that the pace and scale of what the government is doing on social security will quite deliver the policy intentions or the Charter or reduce poverty in Scotland at the pace or scale we need to. Low take-up of benefits is, of course, an age-old issue and one that requires new and revolutionary solutions. Yes.
Neil Gray.
I thank Pam Duncan-Glancy for giving way, and all of us are impatient to move away from the broken Westminster social security system that let down so many people who are looking to seek support. But would she agree with me that the feeling that we got from Social Security Scotland on Monday from some very senior members of Social Security Scotland, including those who have previously worked for the DWP, was that they felt that the move towards delivering new benefits was happening at an incredible pace, to quote their words.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you for the intervention. And I'm not surprised that they've explained or described it like that, because the organisation is new, we're in the middle of a pandemic, and there were four benefits, I think it was highlighted earlier on, that were delivered in an unexpected way. So I'm not denying that what they have done as an organisation to deliver on those parts of the benefits has been quick. But I'm also frustrated and impatient for a change in policy direction, because, as you know, PIP has already excluded, the change from DLA to PIP has already excluded a number of disabled people. You also know, and the committee will have heard, that there are tens of thousands of unpaid carers unable to access the support that they need. And so we do need to move faster on that. I will.
Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you. I'm grateful for the member. Is the member slightly surprised that the regulations at the moment for the new Scottish PIP are almost identical to the PIP which we have at Westminster moment, and was she expecting something slightly more radical and different from this looking forward government?
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
To be honest, I was expecting more from both governments, and I definitely did expect it to be far more radical than what I saw. And I do think we need to move quickly on that, because the poverty that carers, unpaid carers and disabled people are facing is urgent, and we need to take action on it. The Scottish Government itself has recognised that people who are in poverty, disabled people, people who are shielding, children and young people, older people, minority ethnic communities and women have been the hardest hit by the pandemic, but is unable yet to give a clear picture of who these people are, what they're currently claiming and how effectively the social security system is at supporting them. And in the strategy itself, it says that it's very difficult to identify some people, including carers. Now, Presiding Officer, finding a way to identify people is vital, because we've already seen the real-life impact of not having the data that we need. So, for example, 125,000 children who are entitled to the Scottish Child Payment are still missing out on the £10 a week because we don't have the data or the correct information to find them. We've suggested a solution to the government to get around that, and I suggest that they do that. But this chamber will also know that I don't believe £10 a week is anywhere near enough, that these benches don't believe that, and that we can guarantee, however, that having something is significantly better than having nothing. On page 55 of the benefit take-up strategy, the government states that identifying the size of the eligible population for carers' benefits is challenging due to the complexity of eligibility. And the document goes on to say that the situation is the same for young carers and disabled people. This doesn't need to be the case, though. I'm sure the government will know that I've met with carers, as have the Social Security Committee, and disabled people on a number of occasions. And these organisations can identify those groups of people. They can identify carers, where they are and what they should be eligible for. And so I suggest the government can too. The document makes a lot of the government's engagement with carers, but my experience in recent months has not been that they have felt engaged. In fact, they've said they've not felt listened to. But carers need us to do more than listen. They need us and the government to act. And I urge the government to do that, to meet with carers regularly, but not just so that they can learn from them about how to identify who carers are, but also so that they can talk about the way that they can reform carers' assistance in Scotland. I also think to use our social security system to its full potential, we have to prioritise good data on who is and who is not eligible for support. Because if we can't do that, we don't know who needs it and who the system is prioritising. Not having that would limit our ability to see where change is needed. And I urge the government to do more than it is at the minute to improve the quality of the data that it has. But more substantially, the discussion is titled Access to Social Security in Scotland. And unfortunately, in addition to issues with data, and of course the data that we do have shows some that nearly as many as a quarter of children who are entitled to Scottish Child Payment don't get it. Large numbers of people are not accessing it at all at the level they need, or because unfair eligibility criteria that we've already hinted at could remain at least until 2025. Figures for the Welfare Fund, for example, last week showed that repeat crisis applications are at their highest point since the fund began, with more than 3 in 4 of the applications coming from people who have already applied in the past. That suggests to me that people don't have access to the money they need on a long-term and sustainable basis, and instead they're living in a state of crisis, relying on piecemeal grants. We urgently need to provide access to social security for more people at a rate that means they have enough money to live on. And that's why I continue to push the government to go faster and harder on all of this. And this would be consistent with the first principle set out in the uptake strategy around the principle of taking account of individual circumstances and tailoring support in ways which reach and resonate with the intended audience. Organisations like the MS Society have made it really clear that the current eligibility for disabled people's benefits don't do this. They note specifically that the 20-metre rule and the 50% rule for disabled people don't take account of individual circumstances. And since the 20-metre rule came into place, 1 in 3 people with MS moving to PIP have had their support downgraded. And so they say that if it's included in the ADP legislation and there's no prospect of its removal until 2025 after the government's review in 2023 and the time required to implement changes, thousands of people with MS and other conditions will be unable to get the support they need. So instead, the rule which we currently have fails to take account of variable conditions, continues to exist and is a barrier to social security. Leaving eligibility decisions and decisions on new criteria until after full safe and secure rollout is far from person-centred.
If you could begin to wind up now, please.
And my colleagues on these benches have, of course, urged the government to move quickly. Presiding officer, we believe a system that is automated at every point it can be, understands and holds the knowledge of who is eligible for social security in Scotland, and that tells them where and when they can access it is necessary. So let's pick up the pace, do what we can to get on the progress, to make progress on a minimum income guarantee so that no one falls below that, and get on with the job of delivering the powers that we have here in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The pandemic has further exposed the need for Social Security to provide a firm anchor for those in work and out of work. It has shown the need for increased support as well for those who are disabled and for carers. It is vital that we ensure that everyone who should be in receipt of the new payments gets them. And the Minister's communication, the new strategy, seems about right with information, partnership, access, the person-centred approach, all of that I think that we can support. The paper sets out the principles, but my fear, as always, is the actual delivery, which often proves to be a little bit more difficult. I mean, we proposed first the expansion of welfare powers, Social Security powers for Scotland back in the Smith Commission talks, in advance of the 2015 elections. We wanted a £2.5 billion Social Security fund. We wanted more powers, the ability to create new benefits, to top up, and to make sure that we had a system that was fitting in with Scottish principles and approaches as to how we would prefer to see the system. So we've approached this in a very responsible way. We've worked with the government. We believe in the fairness, dignity and respect approach, and we have worked constructively throughout that period. But I have a number of issues that I'd like to raise with the Minister today. The first is the issue of reassessment. Yes,
Neil Gray.
In the aspirations that Willie Rennie and the Liberal Democrats had for a social security system in Scotland, would he have preferred a system where all powers over social security were devolved, or the more difficult situation that we currently face with a hybrid system where we're having to plug in and plug out of the DWP and the barriers that are often put in place by UK ministers?
Willie Rennie.
I mean, this was an active debate through the Smith Commission as to whether you transfer the non-universal credit items, because the universal credit items were considered to be the automatic economic stabilisers, and they were considered to be more appropriate at the single market level, at the UK level, which is why the benefits that were transferred were the non-universal credit items, apart from the ability to flex and to change on some of the universal credit items at a Scottish level. But this was considered actively at the time, which is why we've ended up with the model that we have. I thought it was the appropriate way to proceed. And it has taken the government some time to get those limited number of benefits set up. So probably it was the right decision to take at that time. But the first issue I'd like the Minister to address is the one of reassessment. We've already heard that 39% of people who are in receipt of PIP have a mental health issue, which often is quite a stressful process to go through an assessment. Sam H have highlighted that this often adds to the problems that individuals have, and in fact makes their mental health problems even worse than they started off with. So I recognise the change that has been proposed for the new system to have a more lighter touch 5-yearly process, but I still can't quite understand that if somebody has been judged as having a long-term condition that is unlikely to improve, why they have to go through any kind of reassessment process at all. So perhaps the Minister could explain that in the summing up. I'm also really disappointed by that the Scottish Government, as it currently stands, has decided to adopt broadly the same rules and eligibility criteria as PIP for the new adult disability payment. That means they failed to change the 20-metre rule. So if you can walk one step over 20 metres, you won't receive the higher rate of mobility component. Under PIP, the 20-metre rule has failed people living with NS. And as a result, many people have lost out vital financial support and their independence. This fails to take into account the fluctuating conditions such as MS and the impact invisible symptoms like fatigue can have on the person's mobility. Yes, certainly.
Cabinet Secretary.
A question for Willie Rennie in terms of the risk. So at the moment there is no agreement with the DWP that if we change those rules, which would be difficult to do in the time frame, that the people wouldn't lose all their passporting benefits. Does Willie Rennie think we should just take that risk, or does he agree that an agreement has to be reached first before that happens?
There certainly should be an agreement, and there should be an attempt to make sure that we have the easy transfer of the benefits. But after hearing what ministers have said, in fact, what MPs on the SNP benches have said for years, the impression is that they're not trying hard enough to get that agreement and to make that change. And I think it is important that we do get the change, because many people are losing out. So I want to hear from the Minister what detailed attempts there has been made to make that change, because 5 years ago SNP MPs led a debate in Westminster during which they condemned the 20-metre rule, describing it as Tory ideology and that it was an assault on the disadvantaged. But as we currently stand, they're going to implement that very same rule in Scotland. And the excuses, I'm afraid, are just not good enough. We've got a Scottish government that railed against the UK government but is adopting exactly the same rules for the Scottish system. They're content to carry on with the Tory ideology and assault on the disadvantaged. People with multiple sclerosis and other debilitating conditions will have to wait for another 2 years before it will be looked at again. And the reality is it won't be 2025 before the solution is actually delivered if it is agreed to be changed. Another 4 years away, leaving people hanging on for years. I don't think that's fairness, dignity or respect. So I would expect the ministers to be busting a gut to get that change, to make sure that we can have this rule changed and the rule changed effectively. In the interim, we should have at least the 50-metre rule should be reimposed before that measure is implemented. Then finally, on the carers' benefit, the underlying entitlement issues are a significant issue. They need to be addressed because there is a massive gap between the number of unpaid carers in Scotland and the tiny number who are entitled to receive the carers' allowance.
Please,
currently,
wind up,
is
Mr.
one
Rennie.
In ten. Those of pensionable age are losing out, and there are many other groups too. So I would expect the government to do so much more to get the reality to match up with the rhetoric. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate, and I call Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the positioning of today's debate on the benefit take-up strategy, as it represents more progress in Scotland in cementing a societal shift in the way we think about social security and returning to its founding principles that it is a safety net for those in need and an investment in our constituents. I was lucky enough to be convener of the Social Security Committee during its consideration of the bill and the development of the new system. The Act, of course, sets out the legal framework for the new social security system in Scotland. The focus at that time was to listen to the views of people with lived experience of navigating the UK government system and the DWP. This marked a much needed departure from the government policy and the rhetoric on social security that we had come to be accustomed with from the UK framework. The new system began the process of unpicking hostility and suspicion that people entitled to social security had come to expect under the Conservative government. For the first time, we have a system designed at the outset to protect and promote human rights, placing the Scottish social security principles of dignity, fairness and respect on the face of the bill. And the Scottish Social Security Charter, our charter, sets out what people can expect, and it goes further, including a commitment to support people's well-being when engaging with the Scottish Social Security system. Presiding Officer, I want to reflect, because this is marked contrast to the othering of people and benefits that emanated from Westminster. It was needed because the UK benefit system is punitive and degrading. Just look at the rape clause. I'm lucky enough to take part in the Presiding Officer's Coalition for Racial Equality and Rights intern programme. 1 year, my career intern had to leave this place early, miss her time in the Parliament, because she'd been told she would be sanctioned if she didn't get back to Glasgow for an appointment. Despite taking part in a programme that was designed to build confidence and engage our new Scots in our political life, it was simply unacceptable. But unlike Tory MPs who break the rules with impunity, there was no option for my intern. Last night, we saw the very worst of Conservative contempt for our citizens when they thought they could get away with throwing out the rule book to the benefit of their own. What an insult to my constituents and to their constituents who have been sanctioned for attending family funerals, for caring responsibilities, or for simply being ill. On the Owen Paterson scandal, Chris Frank quoted the Conservative colleague last night, "Justice should always be tempered by mercy." So where is the mercy in the operation of the UK social security system? Not for bereaved constituents, not for those whose loved ones have lost people over losing disability benefit status, not for women who have had to declare rape to access the benefits they are entitled to, and not for those constrained by draconian rules that dominate their lives. If the Conservatives can U-turn on their shameless partisanship displayed this week, they can U-turn on the rape clause and the universal benefit uplift cut. But, Presiding Officer, today is about the benefit take-up strategy, and we have work to do in Scotland, albeit without all the levers at our disposal. The new benefit take-up strategy sets out five principles around which to organise activity to promote take-up. It prioritises person-centred approaches, it communicates and engages effectively, and brings services to people, encouraging cross-system collaboration and continuously learning and improve the service delivered to our constituents. I also note that the Scottish Government will explore the introduction of automated payments for certain devolved benefits, and I would encourage keen consideration of this measure and to any proposal which seeks to remove barriers to access to benefits. Streamlining applications and assessment procedures are important measures to reduce the burden associated with benefits access. We know the stress and strain that benefits applications and particularly continuous reassessment can have from engagement with our constituents. Making applications less onerous may go some way to overcoming the stigma that still exists around social security. For me, the establishment of the social security system stands as one of the great achievements of this Parliament. As policymakers, we must resolve to build upon this work. I'm confident that one day soon we will have social security powers for a system-wide reform of social security. When that day comes, we must embed these same principles of dignity, fairness, respect and compassion into our reforms. Our common humanity and our collective interests can be a driver for this change, and I am confident that this new strategy is another step on the road to a fairer, better Scotland. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Sharon Dowie to be followed by Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For any social security system to succeed, it is an essential requirement that the system delivers. Delivering in the literal way of delivering benefits, delivering in terms of service, and delivering in terms of value for money. It's an interesting exercise to see if Social Security Scotland meets those tests, so please bear with me. Looking at the delivery of benefits by Social Security Scotland, it's clear things aren't going to plan. Yes, some benefits have been delivered, and praise deserves to go to the Social Security Scotland staff on the ground who have made this happen. But in reality, what we are seeing is a far cry from what we were promised. A painfully slow rollout of the Scottish Child Payment, one benefit handed entirely back to the UK Government, and a 4-year delay in the transfer of existing cases from the DWP. "I want to make ending child poverty a driving mission for the next Parliament," said the First Minister. "It is a down payment of what will be possible when we have full powers over tax and social security. But in March 2021, just 1% of applications for the Scottish Child Payment were processed within 10 days.
Ms Stout, could I just ask, could you just raise your microphone, please?
Oh, sorry.
Thank you.
"Most applicants waited 55 days for a decision. That's not quite the down payment the First Minister promised, and certainly not the one working families across Scotland were hoping for. Moving on to my second test, does Social Security Scotland deliver in terms of service? Looking at the figures for client satisfaction, it's clear Social Security Scotland have work to do. Although the Scottish Government's benefit take-up strategy claims Social Security Scotland will be more effective at marketing its services than the DWP, 81% of suggestions from clients this year wanted improvements to the information available from the new agency. Even more telling is that complaints far outweighed compliments, accounting for 77% of feedback received compared to a mere 18% for compliments. Looking at benefits like Best Start Foods, there were 270 complaints about the quality of service and a further 50 regarding accessing the benefit, by far and away the highest figures for any benefit delivered in Scotland. Moving on to child disability payments, it's clear there's communication issues here too. During the pilot programme in Dundee, nearly half of the applications were denied, suggesting work needs to be done explaining the application process and making it understandable to applicants. It's not just at a national level that the service needs improving. Social Security Scotland boasts that they have a presence in every local authority, but that's news to most. In fact, when I called up my local council trying to find details of their local Social Security Scotland team, no. They had never heard of a local delivery office, had never heard of the team, and couldn't signpost to anyone who could help with devolved benefits. I think no means no. Neither does any web page suggest such a team exists other than a single LinkedIn profile I found. Now, if the local benefits team can't signpost an MSP to the devolved benefits office, how do claimants stand a chance? In comparison, the DWP have two offices in Ayr and regularly host job fairs at prominent locations around the town. The local visibility of Social Security Scotland simply has to be improved. It cannot continue to be a backroom operation only known to those in the know. On to my third test, that social security systems need to be cost effective. This idea is enshrined in Social Security Scotland's charter as its final principle. The Scottish social security system is to be efficient and deliver value for money. Where do we begin? The cost of the new system has doubled, staff requirements have doubled, and there's a huge increase in temporary contracts. The Cabinet Secretary has admitted Social Security Scotland will be no more cost-efficient than the DWP, and all this before the Scottish Government have even agreed to double the Scottish Child Payment. Lurking in the horizon is universal basic income. But really, should the Scottish Government be looking to introduce such a payment, particularly when it will cost £58 billion a year? Social Security Scotland were unable to handle 347 million of benefits without doubling their workforce or their budget. So how on earth does the Cabinet Secretary think they'll be able to process £58 billion with ease? And that's even before she sources the funding, which amounts to over three times of current health spending. Surely it is in the interest of ordinary Scots, as well as public finance, to focus on improving the services we have, or maybe even the ones that were handed back to the DWP, rather than launching into a reckless vanity project that fails to target the most vulnerable and hands money to families regardless of their financial status. Presiding Officer, we have the opportunity to build a new system, one tailored to Scotland and that meets the needs of Scotland's people. So let's do that and build the system that Scotland really needs. Thank you.
I call Marie McNair to be followed by Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate. and the benefit take-up strategy set out by the Cabinet Secretary. No one knows when they are just one life experience away from needing support and assistance that will help see them through or ease the burden of financial hardship. A compassionate Scotland has at its heart a social security system that is there for people when they need it, one that puts dignity, fairness and respect at its heart. That goes without saying, in my opinion, I know it is a principle that has a wide support in this Parliament and has been implemented by the Scottish Government. This approach recognises that ensuring people have access to their social security entitlements is incredibly important. They are there for a purpose. They are there because we believe they are the backbone to a just and fair society and a vital investment in the lives of our constituents. If anyone was in two minds about this, the importance of the social security system during the worst of the pandemic and lockdown must surely have ended those doubts. The take-up strategy is a significant contribution to meeting the rights-based approach we are platforming our social security system on. It is a comprehensive approach to ensuring that people have access to the support they are due. It is a strategy that has been shaped and informed by experience of those who have, through no fault of their own, struggled to navigate the system. It has a strong emphasis on continued consultation to really seek out barriers to take up. We know from this approach that there are three key barriers. One, the lack of information. This includes information about the benefits available in the application process. It's obviously important that we address any knowledge defect relating to new benefits, and this is recognised already in the approach set out. Two, costly or complex access. So it's important that we support people to navigate the system and fund advice and support. And three, the social barriers, including perceived stigma. And we must go all out, not just the social security system, but also as politicians, to tackle stigma and bring an end to misconceptions. We must also invest in services that support people, ensure they're accessible in places and in ways that are best suited to people's needs. I therefore welcome the £10 million allocated over this Parliament to help fund this approach. And also say, though, that many councils provide excellent welfare rights services that are in the heart of our communities. And also take this opportunity to praise all welfare rights advice services in Clydebank and Mogai. Local government must be adequately funded to maintain these services, and they must have equality of access to any additional funding. And our dignity, fairness and respect approach is important in increasing take-up too. We should not underestimate how much getting decisions right first time and treating people with compassion will have increasing competence in our social security system. The shameful UK war on welfare for some cheap headlines has created a stigma and cruelty that's been hard to bear. We're right to kick out the private sector assessments that lined the pockets of the rich while inflicting misery on many disabled people who were denied the support of their due. We're right to take a more compassionate approach to terminal illness claims, and we're right to condemn the sanctions regime. We know that it's not an approach to social security that will promote take-up and be there for people when they need it. So policy is important, and that's why when I questioned the Scottish Fiscal Commission at our Social Justice and Social Security Committee, they accepted our changes in policy, meaning that anticipated higher take-up in relation to our adult disability payment compared to the UK equivalent. It's no wonder that Scope, the disability equality charity in England and Wales, have launched a campaign called Disability Benefits Without Fight. They call for a fairer disability assessment process and want to be assessed by those health professionals who actually know about their condition. This doesn't sound like rocket science, does it? Why has the benefit system treated people like this for so long? No thanks. As Scope say, it shouldn't be a fight. Disabled people should get the right benefit, right time, first time round. Scope also points out that between 2017 and 2019, the UK Government spent £120 million on fighting appeals to benefit decisions, £120 million. In Scotland, we must promote the right to appeal and adapt our approach if barriers to taking up the right to challenge a decision are identified. So setting policy to meet our agenda of dignity, fairness and respect will help increase take-up. And this approach, coupled by a take-up strategy that is resourced, person-centred, rejects stigma and gets the message out effectively, will make the difference. Let us unite behind this approach, and we will be travelling to a compassionate, fair and supportive system of social security, one that improves take-up to those who need it and invests in the people of Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Mark Griffin to be followed by Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's debate is welcome and allows me to expand on the evidence I gave to the Social Justice and Social Security Committee on my proposed Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council bill this morning. I'm thankful the committee accepted the statement of reasons, but I'm even more grateful they listened to the workers and trade unionists, members across Unite, USDA, the GMB community, Unison, CWU, the FBU and ASLEV, who wrote to demand a voice and a role in the new Employment Injuries Assistance Benefit. And they wrote in because their colleagues who caught COVID-19 in the workplace and are now no longer fit for work, or simply as women who are apparently the wrong gender for this entitlement, but clearly still get ill or injured through their work, but either don't have access to Industrial Injuries Disablement Benefit or their entitlement is extremely limited, because the Industrial Injuries Disablement Benefit is stuck very much in the last century. Now, any proposed bill in itself won't give women and those with long COVID access to the new Employment Injuries Assistance directly. And government and Parliament need experts who have space, tenure and independence to research the illnesses and diseases and make their recommendations based on that. But it is inconceivable these issues would not be considered by a body with the authority and power to consider those issues, to make the first steps on a road to make this entitlement fit for the 21st century. And the trade unionists and workers getting ill at work today must have a mandated seat at the table of a permanent, statutory and independent employment advisory council. Their expertise, their lived experience of actual 21st century workplaces is vital to make proposals that reform this benefit from the very start. And, Presiding Officer, I put it to committee this morning that would this Parliament, when it considers regulations for a new devolved benefit, accept an equalities impact assessment that said just 6% of applications would come from women? And clearly the answer is no, we absolutely would not. But that would be the case if a lift and shift approach is taken, because to do so risks embedding a system that promotes inequalities and fails to reflect modern Scotland. And I'm thankful to the GMB Women's Campaign Unit, Engender, Close the Gap and Professor Andrew Watterson for their substantial insight on the issue of women's health and safety at work. Because right now women have so little access to the Westminster benefit because they have barely any entitlement to it. It's a benefit for the injuries and diseases that men got in workplaces they predominantly worked in during the last century. Cleaners with respiratory and skin diseases are not recognised by the current scheme. Breast cancer caused by shift work, the top occupational cancer in women, is not recognised. Even asbestos-related ovarian cancer, the most common gynecological cancer in the UK, women are missing from that scheme. And care workers as well, they wrote to the committee to say they risk injury at work daily, they have musculoskeletal disorders in the neck and upper limbs, have injuries ignored by employers, and the outdated UK benefit system. And of course, changes would not happen overnight, but you do need a system to do the work and consider that change, and we don't have that in Scotland right now. New data and analysis, broad expertise and testimony will be needed to make the case for change. So I'm grateful to the Association of Personal Injury Lawyers, Thompson's, the Royal Society of the Prevention of Accidents and the British Occupational Health Society, who offered their support and insight too. The committee also heard from people who have long COVID or who have colleagues with long COVID and who likely caught it through the course of their work. And the impetus for my bill proposal was in response to their experience. Shouldn't people who were contracting COVID at work have access to a newly devolved benefit? Workers in health, social care, retail and public transport spoke of how they were becoming so severely ill long COVID was impacting their ability to continue to do their work, the jobs they loved, and something should be done to support them. But in March this year, the UK Advisory Council refused to recognise COVID, and that exposes the risk in our social security system in deferring to a UK council over which the Scottish ministers have no power to request advice from. And so there is less progress on Scottish benefits and those key workers who we depended on and rightly applauded throughout the pandemic. They are offered no access to the industrial injuries benefit. A Scottish council with powers to commission the research and make recommendations on how to support people who caught COVID at work could offer hope the new benefit will give people access to social security so desperately lacking in the UK entitlement. Now, in the coming weeks, I'll be lodging my final proposal for a statutory Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council that can research, date and scrutinise the new benefit, but also one which makes sure the workers and trade unionists injured in the course of their employment, especially women and those with long COVID, are at the heart of that council. Sir, when it comes to accessing Scottish Social Security benefits, I hope to work closely with the Cabinet Secretary, the Minister, the Social Justice and Social Security Committee and members across the Chamber to ensure full access, equal access, to the new Employment Injuries Assistance fit for the 21st century. Thank you.
Thank you. Before we move to the next speaker, members may wish to be aware that we have ample time in hand currently for interventions, for example, and I call Emma Roddick to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am acutely aware of the need to address issues in social security access and take-up. As a member of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, I hear a lot about the difficulty that people, and particularly people with mental illness, face in applying for and then dealing with the gatekeepers of social security like PIP. I'm very hopeful that given the principles it was created on, Social Security Scotland will not follow that same route. It's very telling to me that SAMH are already pointing out the advantages of the approach of Social Security Scotland, despite the criteria for ADP being the same as PIP. How we treat those who ask for help is such a massive part of building a system which respects and ensures the dignity of those that it supports. Certainly.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you. And I share the... I share your congratulating the government on the changes to some of the processes around it. I share that approach. But would you also agree then that the 50% rule around the amount of time that something has to be present is particularly difficult for people with mental ill health, and in fact that part of the eligibility criteria for personal independence payment is something that really does need to be addressed, and that we need to do that soon rather than wait until 2025?
Emma Roddick.
I thank the member for her intervention, and I know that she has a lot of great ideas and that we probably have quite a lot of shared experiences of going through social security so far, and I'll look forward to having those debates when the criteria for ADP is what we're discussing. Isn't it a real shame, though, that a mental health charity telling us that PIP actually drags people into mental health crises is not surprising in this country? Isn't it just devastating to think that before changing the amount paid for or the eligibility for benefit, just speaking to the recipient like a person is a massive change? I've been through the grueling process of applying for and then trying to hold on to universal credit twice in my life, so I am no stranger to the often dehumanising process of trying to interact with the DWP as a disabled person. My committee colleague Miles Briggs was right to point out in his speech that mentally ill people who access PIP often experience stress, but I think it's important to recognise as well that often it's not just stress, it's trauma and severe harm that these people are experiencing. In my first PIP assessment, which was many years ago now, I was grilled about my mental illness. My doctor had written a letter supporting my application and, amongst other things, noted that I had suffered from suicidal ideation. The assessor asked me if that were true, what had prevented me from acting on the suicidal thoughts? Basically, why are you alive then? And I think it was clear that they believed that I was either a failure or a liar. Like most people in this room, I've also helped constituents apply for benefits and provided emotional support to them as they went for assessment. I've also done that with friends. getting the help that you need in order to survive should not be such a traumatic experience. The very first principle of the new benefit take-up strategy is to prioritise person-centred approaches. It's a very government phrase, but also very reassuring, because it demonstrates the Scottish Government's intention to put the recipients of social security first. And I'm proud to be a member of the party which is seeking to take Scotland in a different direction. The agency in charge of administering benefits is, of course, not the only thing affecting take-up, although, you know, through speaking to constituents, I know that stigma is still very much playing a part in damaging the willingness of people who need help and are eligible to receive it to apply. I don't think anyone's going to learn anything today from me saying that people often look down on those who rely on social security, but decent social security is not a thing to avoid, judge or disparage. It is a sign of a fair, caring society. During October recess, I visited a number of organisations in Inverness who focus on food poverty, and included in that was a community cupboard and a community fridge. They're not a new concept in the Highlands and Islands, but their numbers increased drastically over the pandemic as people became more aware of those who were struggling to feed themselves and their families, and others who would otherwise never have experienced poverty were suddenly plunged into it through loss of work, illness or other pandemic-driven life events. I think it's right that I recognise as well the role that HTSI, Highland Third Sector Interface, played in supporting those who dreamt big ideas of helping their community to put it into action, and hosting a food provision map on their website, which signposts people to their nearest provider, whether that's a food bank in Inverness or an oyster delivery service in Kinlochbervie, or one of dozens of community fridges, cupboards and gardens that now exist across the Highlands. What I really love about these community fridges is they're not just there for people who are on low incomes. That stigma that I mentioned earlier doesn't apply. They not only exist to give food to people who don't have any, but they stop food waste from supermarkets making it to landfill. That means that when you're walking into these places and leaving with your dinner, it doesn't mean you're poor, it means that you're saving the planet. Of course, I'd much rather that we get to the point where living in poverty isn't something that you hide, it's just something that happens to you that you're then helped out of. Presiding Officer, I'm not ashamed to have relied on social security and food parcels. That experience is a part of who I am, and I consider it incredibly valuable when I'm speaking in this place and undertaking scrutiny work in committee. Food parcels actually broadened my culinary horizons as well. I expected beans, pasta and other familiar items in my parcel, but I was also introduced to tin crab for the first time in my life through one particularly memorable package. I'm telling you that because I believe very much in two things. First, that input from those with lived experience is critical to making good policy decisions. And second, that an MSP talking about being on social security will normalise it and maybe help reduce the stigma. I trust that these are beliefs shared by the Scottish Government, evidenced by their history consulting with often unheard groups and their commitment to continue that work. And I'm grateful for their determination to change the experience of disabled people and others who need social security in Scotland for the better.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Ruddock. I now call on Maggie Chapman, who will be followed by Stuart McMillan. 6 minutes, please, Maggie.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin by thanking those who work to support the distribution of social security to so many people across Scotland. And I'd also like to thank those who support recipients in voluntary sector organisations, in local authorities and elsewhere. We see you and we value you. And I think it would be remiss of me not to acknowledge the personal testimonies we've heard in this chamber this afternoon. It does make a difference, as my colleague Emma Roddick has just said, for people out there to see us standing here with lived experience. Scotland is reinvesting in our vital social security system after more than a decade of cuts. The child payment, which Greens will fight to at least double as soon as possible, could invest over £320 million in our children by the end of the Parliament. The Young Carer Grant, championed by us in Parliament, is providing thousands of young carers with yearly grants to help them enjoy some time away from their caring roles. But that these and other extra supports will be of no use to people who are not aware of their entitlements. They will be of no use to people who need a bit of help to apply. And they will be of no use to people who are too embarrassed to apply because of years of shameful attacks on them by governments and others. The child payment could not come soon enough, but the Scottish Fiscal Commission estimates that 25% of children, 86,000, will not receive the support they are entitled to. And that is not including those children who miss out because their families do not claim the qualifying UK payments. And those are just the payments we know about. Scotland will soon deliver disability and carer payments to hundreds of thousands of Scots with no official estimates of how many people might be eligible. I would urge the Cabinet Secretary to explore how such estimates could be produced. Fighting poverty with social security payments that don't get to everyone they target is like fighting it with one hand tied behind our backs. But it doesn't have to be this way. Child benefit take-up is regularly above 90%, reaching 97% in some years recently. And around 96% of new families apply for their baby box. So what can we do? First, we must tackle head-on the stigma created by 40 years of lies about benefit claimants from successive Westminster governments and the media. Second, we need to expand high-quality income maximisation advice. Some evaluations show as much as £20 return for every pound invested. NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde's Healthier, Wealthier Children project, championed by us in Parliament, has over 10 years got an estimated £36 million into the pockets of new parents by supporting midwives and health visitors to signpost to money advice services. And this is why I'm so pleased that the Shared Scottish Government, Scottish Greens policy programme commits an additional £10 million for such services. And I really look forward to seeing how that will be spent as soon as possible. Third, we need to be proactive in getting money to people. When they approach Social Security Scotland or local government for support, we should be actively checking what other payments may be on offer that they can claim. And with the right information and the right IT, we can make automatic payments to people without them even having to apply in the first place. Glasgow City Council has proved this is possible with school clothing grants, and I'm very pleased that the Shared Policy Programme commits to expanding this approach too. We must also make progress on making disability payments more accessible. Regular face-to-face assessments, not necessary in 20 years of disability living allowance, were introduced by the UK government to make disability payments harder to access, demonising and stigmatising the people who tried. Applicants have been forced to travel many miles, sometimes to inaccessible buildings, to attend assessments conducted by assessors entirely ignorant of their condition. In some cases, applicants' health conditions have been significantly worsened, entirely the opposite intention of the disability benefit system. Our new Scottish adult disability payment could be transformative. Some decisions may be reached using the application form and accompanying information without the need for further assessment. A green win from 2018, and something that I'm very proud of. But where a conversation with the applicant is needed, the new client consultation system promises to be less intrusive and more respectful. We need to make sure that people who have those conversations have the information they need about the people that they are talking to. And I do hope, I urge the Minister and Cabinet Secretary to address the concerns with the 20-metre rule. When this payment launches next year, disabled people, their organisations and Greens will be watching developments carefully to ensure these promises are upheld. For too long, Presiding Officer, governments have been deliberately putting up barriers to people in accessing social security. It does not have to be that way. We, all of us, but particularly the Scottish Government, should be tearing those barriers down. And I'm very pleased to see the Greens play a vital role in that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call on Stuart McMillan, who's joining us remotely, who will be followed by Alexander Stewart. Mr McMillan, around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, first of all, I'm pleased to be speaking in this debate. I would have much preferred to have actually been in the chamber today, but as you can tell from my voice, still struggling a wee bit with some illness. I highlight this because the continuation of the virtual sessions has actually allowed me today and other MSPs to still work and contribute from home instead of not being able to participate in the chamber. Today's debate is important, and I welcome both the 2019 strategy and now the 2021 benefit take-up strategy. And as the Cabinet Secretary said in her earlier remarks, the new strategy is based upon five key principles. First of all, prioritise person-centred approaches. Secondly, communicate and engage effectively. Thirdly, bring services to people. Fourthly, encourage cross-system collaboration. And the fifth point is continuously learn and improve. Now, I don't think there are any of those principles that any MSP can disagree with. The process is crucial, and quite rightly, it should be scrutinised, but most importantly, for me, are the outcomes. The outcomes for our fellow citizens who need to engage with Social Security Scotland to obtain the benefits that they are entitled to. Every one of us will have heard the claim of people, and I quote, milking the system, and also quote, the benefit scroungers. If the UK welfare system is overly complicated and people obtain resources because of it, I don't blame the people. I blame the system and how it was established. And in the same vein, that same complicated UK welfare system has allowed many people to miss out on benefits who have desperately needed them over the years. I highlight these two examples, President Officer, for a specific reason. I accept that establishing any new system will not be without challenges, and some unforeseen issues will be found along the way. There clearly are questions about the formulation process of any system. However, the challenge for any government is how they fix them. And as we have seen with universal credit and the desperate state many of our constituents have been in because of it, and then the failed amendments to it, I hope the Scottish Government and this Scottish Parliament never make those two mistakes. This is why I found the new strategy to be refreshing, person-centred, continual learning and improvement, and encouraging cross-system collaboration. Now, the latter will clearly be the toughest challenge, of course. Through stakeholder engagement, the Scottish Government has identified that the following is the main barriers to preventing the take-up of benefits. First of all, the lack of information, unawareness or misperceptions about the benefit, entitlement or application procedures. Also, the costly or complex access. That was inhibiting complexity of the application procedure or the lack of resources, including time, limited competences to find somebody's way through the system, and also travel to the welfare or employment office. A couple of things that we've already heard from others today. And the third point is the social barriers, the perceived stigma, subjective lack of need or pride or lack of trust in institutions. Now, sadly, the stigma about claiming benefits is real for many people. I've had constituents who didn't want to apply for benefits because of their pride. They didn't feel they needed to and wanted the money to go to others, even though there were some people that this additional resource would have benefited their life greatly. Now, we've already heard from colleagues, including the excellent speech from Emma Roddick today, about the issue of stigma. And I agree with colleagues about the issue of stigma. We have to do something better about that. And in the Scotland that I want to see the stigma of obtaining benefits removed. There will be some MSPs, including Emma Roddick, who have never needed to access benefits, but there are others who have, including Emma Roddick and myself. For those of us who have, it was a sobering experience, but also one that stays with you. This is why I absolutely endorse the three key principles of the benefits controlled by this Parliament: dignity, fairness, and respect. The new strategy is going to deliver a few aspects which I believe will help many of my Greenock and Inverclyde constituents, as well as across the nation. Firstly, actions from the strategy, which will build on learning from the 2019 strategy, include working with partners to improve targeting of information and advice, challenging the myths and stigma around claiming benefits, and also continuing to remove barriers to accessing Social Security in Scotland. There's also the other point, and that's the rollout of Social Security Scotland's local delivery network with 400 staff and 32 local authorities. By the time the service is fully operational, that is going to be crucial. This will also enhance the many public sector and third sector organisations, including Financial Fitness and Christians Against Poverty, who both operate in my constituency. In addition to this, I believe that establishing a stakeholder take-up forum, proactively identifying examples of best practice, as well as settings in which they might be replicated, will be hugely beneficial, in addition to working with stakeholders to co-design interactive and helpful resources to support the mainstreaming of existing good practices around benefit take-up. Presiding Officer, there's also the multi-channel financial wellbeing marketing campaign covering free debt advice, affordable credit and beginning with a focus on benefit take-up. That's going to be vital, in particular the important work that credit unions undertake in our constituencies can play an even greater part in this activity. And with that, I was delighted to meet with the Taylor the Bank Credit Union in my Greenock and Inverclyde constituency only recently, and I know how important they are to their clients, but also the opportunities that they can deliver for many more people. And finally, working with a range of specific seldom heard groups to better understand and address non-take-up among particular populations is vital. Scotland is a country with a rich tapestry of backgrounds, and I warmly welcome that. Therefore, understanding some of the cultural challenges is vital to actually ensure that all new Scots are equal partners in our nation. To conclude with, Presiding Officer, we all know that as part of the national mission to tackle poverty, the Scottish Government is determined that everybody should be able to access the payments that they are due. I believe this new strategy, but more importantly, the outcomes from it, will actually help to achieve this mission. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McMillan. I now call on Alexander Stewart, who will be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. 6 minutes, Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Ensuring help is given to those who need it most is the most important function of every social security system. These benches believe in the implementing and ensuring that a distinctly Scottish approach for social security, one which is targeted towards the need of the people of Scotland and backed by the broad financial shoulders of the United Kingdom. And the key to achieving this function is ensuring that everyone who is entitled to receive help is not only able to access, but is encouraged to do so. Thus far, however, the government's record on delivering social security benefits is something that needs to be questioned, because there is still much more further attention to detail that is required. It has often been reported that the SNP will not finish tackling all their devolved benefit powers until 2025. That is nearly a decade after they first received these powers, Deputy Presiding Officer. We also know that the Social Security staffing costs have nearly doubled, and we must be aware of these spiralling costs. Nevertheless, moving forward, there is still the opportunity for the Scottish Government to put things right and to ensure that the Social Security Scotland begins to deliver more benefits. But when it comes to the forthcoming adult disability payment, for example, it seems the Scottish Government still have work to do to ensure that all claimants receive the appropriate level of award. The previous Social Security Secretary stated earlier in the year that DWP-style assessments would play no part in the application process for the benefits. The recently published benefit take-up strategy confirms that face-to-face assessments will only take place when absolutely necessary and are not to be and are now to be renamed as client consultations. But this is will depend on in clients themselves applying and dealing with the application form, and accompanying medical evidence raises concerns because they may not be able to provide sufficient evidence without undergoing the type of assessment currently used toward PIP. While some potential claimants will be able to retrieve the required medical reports from general practitioners, there will be many clients and claimants who will not have visited a general practitioner often enough to be able to do that, and that could put them at a disadvantage. As such concerns have been talked about with the DWP, it is talked about the scrapping of the face-to-face assessment, many claimants will be unable to provide enough evidence to receive the level of award that they may be entitled to. And that has to be a looked at, Deputy Presiding Officer. Happy to take an intervention.
Minister.
At that point, thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank Mr Stewart for taking the intervention. I think it's important to recognise that when it comes to adult disability payment and in the system that we are building, that only one piece of information from a formal source will be required to support the general care and mobility needs in a client's application. And this will be a marked departure from the current system, which requires formal supporting information to evidence each and every difficulty that the client reports experiencing. So that's one of several examples of how the way we deliver disability benefits will be significantly different in terms of the experience of the client when applying.
Mr Stewart, I'm happy to reimburse your time there.
Thank you, President. I thank the Minister for the intervention. He acknowledges that there is to be differences and changes, and so do we. We want to see that tailored approach, so it's very important, but we also have to recognise that there will be some difficulties, and if people are not able to access all what they have, then they will slip through the net, and we want to ensure you've got the time, the process and the funds to ensure, Minister, that that takes place, and we want to ensure that that does take place. Because it is important that to make sure that anyone who is applying for any type of benefit is given the support, the mechanisms that they need. Indeed, the whole idea of improving the potential for payments from the Scottish Government and that the risks that could be dealt with that have to be looked at. Where there are similar pressures, claimants receiving the highest rate of PIP, that is important. None of us want to see that the approach that's taken to ensure that clients and claimants have that in consideration. So there will have to be looked at considerations about the potential pitfalls that are required. But turning to other aspects, Deputy Presiding Officer, the Social Security system is there and is welcomed. The benefit take-up strategy has been talked about today in the Chamber, and I acknowledge the importance of tailoring support under certain demographics. It would also be the idea to look at older people, and many older people face barriers to accessing their benefits and do not take up their benefits because of the access issues that they have. One such barrier is demonstrated from our Citizens Advice Scotland when they talked about 1 in 10 people aged between 65 and 79 are not able to use a computer effectively to ensure that they can assess and make the applications, and that becomes much more difficult for someone in that age group. And as I say, the charity have looked at that and assessed that. It should also be stressed that changes to the benefits can both be confusing and stressful to older people who depend on them, and therefore we should be looking at communication. Communication is vitally important, and I know the Scottish Government has looked at some of this, but there are areas that still require to be addressed because it needs to be done well, and it needs to be done timelessly. So, in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, it's important that the Government continue to engage with the older people and stakeholders and charities. Organisations like Age Scotland have also talked about what requires to be done. But another area that's been talked about today is those who are in the caring issue and those who are caring for others. I welcome the Government's take-up strategy, acknowledging the simplicity of the carers' allowance application process, and that needs to be looked at because it will be replaced by the Scottish Carers Assistance. Given the increasing importance of carers over the last 18 months, it's vital now that we look at that group and that we ensure that they are given the support they require. Deputy Presiding Officer, as I stated at the outset, it is clear that the devolved benefit power Scotland has received are something which I use properly can be very effective and can be a tool to support and ensure that society gets the support they need. It is therefore disappointing that we have not gone as far down the road to delivering these as we had hoped, but the Scottish Government is able to listen, and I'm sure will take on board some of the comments that have been held here today about some of the concerns that many people have in the Chamber, and I hope that we can arrive at a social security system with other countries can aspire to, but at the moment, as we see it so far, it is still looking as a missed opportunity, and I'm disappointed that we are looking at a missed opportunity, Deputy Presiding Officer. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Mr Stewart, before calling the final speaker in the open debate, I just remind members who participated in the debate that they need to be here for closing speeches. And with that, I call Faisal Chowdhury for around 6 minutes. Mr Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It gives me a great pleasure to speak in today's debate. Deputy Presiding Officer, the devolution of welfare powers gives us the chance to shape what kind of society we want to be. The chance to restore dignity and respect to the heart of the social security system. Yet now we know that the delay on the SNP has only halted the progress and effects that potentially benefit take-up for Scotland. There can be no doubt that COVID-19 has hit low-income families and the most vulnerable disproportionately hard, deepening poverty and dragging more families into financial insecurity. Today, half of the families in poverty have a member who is a disabled person, and even before the pandemic, child poverty rates were high and projected to rise further. Over the next decade, Scotland must be bold, must be willing to use the full levers of power to transform. If we are to meet our target on child poverty and live up to our ambitions of being a nation that respects, protects, and fulfills human rights, and where we can all achieve our potentials. We can start, of course, with the Scottish Child Payment, something that has continued to be on the minds of the Chamber, thanks to the effort from my friend and colleague, Pam Duncan-Glancy. Just over a quarter of Scottish children live in poverty in Scotland, 260,000 children right now in 2021. That's something we should be ashamed of, shame us all. We talk a lot, but this Parliament need to be seriously get ambitious for Scotland children. Let's raise the Scottish child payments to £40 a week. Let's ensure that every kid in Scotland have a good quality of life without the people they love them having to worry about where the money is coming from. Even with the full rollout, the Scottish Government is likely to miss their interim child poverty target by 6%, leaving an extra 50,000 children in poverty. The cruel cut to universal credit, thanks to the Tories, and the Scottish Government delays to rolling out and increasing its Scottish family incomes, when they are already having to deal with the economic shock dealt by the pandemic. We can and must do better. Presiding Officer, for those with lifelong conditions, they look at this chamber and ask, how are we going to defend them? For example, those with MS are looking for hope. The MS Society, Labour and many other organisations are all calling for the removal of 20 metres rule from the proposed adult disability payment. The Scottish Government are replacing PIP with ADP, and as part of this new benefit, the Government has largely replaced the PIP eligibility criteria, including retaining the 20-metre rules as part of the assessment criteria for ADP. A Citizen Advice Scotland survey in 2021 found that a majority of Bureau advisers working to help people with disabilities navigate that social security system agree that the 20-metre rule should be extended to 50 metres. Fatigue, both physical and mental, is one of the most debilitating symptoms of MS and other neurological conditions. The rule does not consider the severity of fatigue many will experience after walking 20 metres. So I would be grateful if the Government can respond to concerns raised by those who have MS. Is the Government prepared to change the eligibility criteria because those claiming disability payment deserve dignity and respect? Presiding Officer, the social security system we shape in this Parliament must ensure no one is held back by poverty and inequality. Scottish Labour would use the power we have here in Scotland to make sure that people have the support they need to participate fully in society. The social security system Labour would build to secure the well-being and human rights of everyone and seek to guarantee a minimum income standard that no one would fall below. Having a strong, adequate and automated SSS will lead to a higher level of take-up. Scottish Labour will build a social security system based on the principle of adequacy, respect and simplicity. Those are the principles that will guide me as we come together to shape our social security for Scotland to ensure it works for all. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Chaudhry. We now move to closing speeches, and I call Paul O'Kane for around 6 minutes, Mr. O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I want to begin my remarks by thanking all the organisations who provided briefing material ahead of today's debate. We've heard, I think, about the Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland and the MS Society in particular for their work in this area. The creation of Social Security Scotland is testament to the power of devolution, and we want to use the powers to ensure that they make a real impact on people's lives. And I think that is the degree of consensus that we heard in the Chamber today, and indeed the Cabinet Secretary began by talking about that human rights approach that we would want to see. And indeed, I think we've heard across the Chamber that there is a cross-party effort required in terms of being able to get this right. And I do hope that we will have further opportunities to discuss this matter in the Chamber. And indeed, today we will end our debate without a vote on a motion or amendments. But I do think it is important that we come back to this in order to allow opposition parties to continue a scrutiny of this process to try and get the best outcomes possible in terms of allowing people to access new benefits. Indeed, today's publication of the strategy by the Scottish Government has shown, I think, that there are gaps in terms of the knowledge of who is using our social security system and how we can encourage them to uptake the benefits that they are entitled to. I'll start perhaps by reflecting on what my colleague Faisal Chowdhury has just covered in terms of the Scottish Child Payment. And indeed, Pam Duncan-Glancy spoke to this in her remarks as well. The data published shows that only 77% of eligible households are getting access to that payment. And it means that even with further investment, we are not reaching almost a quarter of the families who indeed are entitled to it. And we know from organisations like the Child Poverty Action Group exactly what we can and must do to get to that extra 23%. And to ensure that we're investing in areas where applications are analysed so as to better identify the families who are eligible. And I think data is key here. With data in hand, the Scottish Government should be able to reach out to more families and put that money into their pockets. And we know how crucial that is in lifting more of Scotland's young people out of poverty. And again, I think colleagues have referred to that in the debate this afternoon. So we do see a need to further invest in the system, and I think we all agree on that. There is a degree of consensus around ensuring that we have a system that works, that knows where people are and seeks to meet them. With this in mind, I think it's clear that the strategy published has quite a degree of detail in what has come before. But I am concerned that there's a lack of detail, perhaps, on the strategic approach to increasing benefit uptake under the new system. And I think what Alexander Burnett said in terms of targeting priority groups is key here. And I think we also heard that echoed by Miles Briggs in his contribution around the support for different groups of individuals, such as people who suffer from poor mental health and who have been supported by SAMH. We do need to see, I think, more done in terms of reaching those groups, finding out what the barriers are, and working with them to ensure they get access to their benefits. And I think we heard very powerfully from a number of members this afternoon about stigma, and we know that that continues to be a real barrier for people. And I do hope that the Minister will say something on that in terms of his summing up. We heard this afternoon about the importance, I think, of automation in the benefit system. Maggie Chapman made reference to that, as did other colleagues. Automation has really been a central priority for the Scottish Labour Party, and we believe that automation would effectively overcome many of the significant barriers to take up, which can often be a lack of knowledge of entitlements. Indeed, if an individual could make one claim that would automatically trigger their entitlements for other supports, that would have a hugely positive upward impact on take-up rates and would most importantly help to reduce and prevent poverty and support people's well-being. Another key area we have heard from speakers across the chamber today has been one that has been raised by the MS Society around the issues surrounding the adult disability payment and the end of the 20-metre rule. And it was referenced, of course, by Willie Rennie, Faisal Chowdhury, Pam Duncan-Glancy and others. The 20-metre rule is one that is incompatible with a system that is based on dignity, respect and fairness. And I believe it's an archaic rule that stipulates the degree in which you can walk, then justifying the enhanced rate that you receive or not. And it harms people who have disabilities. It takes money out of people's pockets, and therefore they lose independence. And we know that across the debate today, what we've heard is that if you limit someone's independence and their ability to socialise and to go to work and to lead a more normal life, that has huge ramifications and impacts. So I think we do have a lot more work to do in terms of perhaps righting the wrongs of past systems to ensuring better uptake. We've heard this afternoon from colleagues speaking about the importance of advocacy and advice. Mary McNair, of course, referred to, I think, to the importance of local government in that, in terms of funding welfare rights and advice, and I think we would all want to see that at the heart of this system as well. And my colleague Mark Griffin spoke very passionately about his bill, which I do hope the Cabinet Secretary will accept Mark's offer of wanting to work in a spirit of partnership around that agenda. And certainly I think that further dialogue must be had there. Deputy Presiding Officer, in concluding, there is often a temptation, I think, to make this debate about UK Government versus Scottish Government, Westminster versus Holyrood. And I think some people have strayed into that temptation a little this afternoon. But I think what I have seen, and I think what Emma Roddick really spelled out for us all most powerfully, is it's about the importance of lived experience, and it's about people's lives and ensuring that we all work together collectively, that we drive cooperation between governments in order to support our constituents who need support of social security the most. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr O'Kane. I now call on Jeremy Balfour to conclude for the Conservatives. Around 7 minutes, Mr Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I just remind members that I am in receipt of a higher rate of PIP. I believe that the best way for the vulnerable in our society to be aided is for a devolved level. It is pretty self-evident that those who are closer to the communities we seek to help can more effectively identify needs and provide tailored solutions. For this reason, I find the principle of Social Security Scotland exciting and seeing it having great potential. I too, like others, visited it on Monday. And we have an opportunity to build a uniquely Scottish system that is tailor-made to deal with people and circumstances here in Scotland, all the while having robust and reliable underwriting of the DWP. And this underwriting is the benefit of Scotland being served by two governments. We can have different localised policies with the same financial backing. For example, something that I think we could look at doing extremely differently would be to rethink how we treat those with MS, epilepsy and other such disabilities. Others have already picked this up this afternoon. Having a tapered system that made their support directly proportionate to the regularity of their episodes could potentially be a great way to ensure the vulnerable in Scotland are served efficiently and effectively. I am slightly confused this afternoon. The Cabinet Secretary said we can't do this change because there's no agreement between DWP. The Minister last week at committee said we want to transfer everybody safely across and then look at it. So even if there was an agreement in place, the insinuation from the Minister last week was that we wouldn't make the changes, and perhaps he could clarify that in his concluding remarks.
Cabinet Secretary.
So there are two key points here. One is that if you open up a different system, you'll then be running two systems concurrently, which would be really complex and difficult because people would want to go on to the better system. So that's the first risk, which Scots have identified would be a serious risk. And the second is that without that agreement with the DWP, then that risks passporting benefits. And although a lot of dialogue has taken place, that agreement is not there. So there are two fundamental risks there, which I'm sure Jeremy Balfour will appreciate and understand.
Jeremy Balfour.
I understand those risks, but if there could be an agreement reached with DWP, I agree with Mr Rennie. I think that should happen much sooner than 2025, which will be the earliest possible date. And this is one of the many ways that the Scottish welfare system could be implemented. The devolution of these benefits presents an amazing opportunity to seek welfare in ways that Scotland wants. And of course, that is what the SNP want. An opportunity for them to radically change the system from Westminster, to get rid of this unfair, heartless system that we can keep going on about. But what's happened? The draft regulations that have come out, the conversations that we're having today, all point to the fact that they're going to keep the same regulations that we have at the moment. No change in regard to the 50% rule. No change in regard to those who have MS. No change to look at mobility. Simply the old system copied and pasted into Scottish legislation. And this is a missed opportunity. As my colleague Miles Briggs pointed out, only 4 years ago, the government estimated that setting up Social Security Scotland would cost £307 million. However, the reality is that the cost has risen to an eye-watering £650 million. I don't know about you, Deputy President Officer, but I struggle to think of many private sector organisations would categorise a project coming in more than 100% over budget as anything rather than an unmitigated disaster. Again, we are led to believe that the agency would require 1,900 staff to run. But again, the SNP illusions exist, and we see that we have now doubled to 3,500. My colleague, Sharon Dowie, has already pointed out how desperately slow the government's rollout of the Scottish Child Payment has been. As she described, only 1% of applications were processed within 10 days in March 2021, with most applicants waiting 55 days for a decision. And this is an easy benefit to implement. It means more time for families worrying about their finances and stability. I'm afraid not a moment. And while we are on that subject, the Scottish Child Payment, the SNP Green Government are yet to commit to doubling this payment for the next financial year, delaying vital funds from reaching those who need it most. Every party in this chamber agrees that it should be doubled, and yet the SNP refuse for reasons that are frankly beyond me. And all this points to an SNP Green Government that is failing Scotland on social security. They have taken an initiative that had so much potential and injected with their painted nationalism and just simply failed to deliver for the average person in Scotland. And it's been pointed out time and time again, and echoed again this afternoon by my colleague Alexander Stewart, that this is the same Scottish Government that claims it could set up a fully independent Scotland in 18 months. On this basis of the 10-year wait that this country will have to wait for them to take control of devolved social security, why should we believe their pipe dream about anything else that they promised to deliver? And the scary thing is, President Officer, it comes to independence. The SNP won't be able to go back to the UK Government for help when we come up against these harsh realities of governance. Finally, I would like the Minister, in his winding up, to thank DWP again for all the amazing work we have done in Scotland, for supporting the Scottish Government, for billing them out time in, time out again. If it hadn't been for DWP, the most vulnerable in our society would have been let down by this Government. They have failed to deliver, they have failed in their promises, and we will scrutinise them again and again until we get it right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. I now call on the Minister to wind up for the Government. Around 9 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Plain Officer. The strategy that we are considering today, as well as the associated issues around it, is of course about how we in the Scottish Government, but also asking how we as a society work together to improve how we get all of those across our society who are entitled to social security to get what they are due. It's about working with partners to improve the targeting of information and advice. It's about challenging myths and stigma around claiming benefits. And it's about continuing to remove barriers to accessing social security in Scotland and more widely. It's about encouragement, engagement and empowerment, information and support. And yes, changing social attitudes about how as a society we approach the concepts of social security and welfare. Because as the Cabinet Secretary rightly emphasised in her opening remarks, social security is a collective investment in ourselves and each other. It's a human right. And for too much and for too long in the United Kingdom, the critics of social security have been able to be too loud and have set too much of the tone. As Stuart McBenefit scroungers have been phrases that have echoed far too much throughout our media and commentary emphasised, that is a responsibility that is shared between politicians and those in the media who have amplified those negative and unhelpful positions. It's almost baffling, actually, isn't it, to think about how much criticism there has been of the concept of social security throughout recent decades. This is a system that's about helping people, and yet, in very many different quarters, it has been a source of negative criticism. Certainly.
Pam Duncan Glancy.
Thank you for taking the intervention. And I recognise the way that you've described the toxicity, actually, in the debate around social security in recent years, but also, as you've rightly pointed out, in the last few decades. On that basis, then, I ask again if you will move to take the 20-metre rule out of adult disability payment and commit to doing that. Now, we can discuss about when you'll do it, but all the conversation and the chat that we're hearing about the human rights approach to social security isn't going to fundamentally change how much money people get in their pockets or who gets it unless we do that. So can I ask you again to commit to doing that?
Ms Duncan Glancy, if I could ask you to direct your comments through the chair, that would be helpful. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Pam Duncan Glancy and others who've raised that important point, and I will come on to it in due course in my closing remarks. But just to go back to the conceptual points that I was making, I thought it was interesting when I was thinking about this debate, I looked at some of the history around the time of the conception of this Parliament, and I found this quote from Tony Blair in 1999, which of course was the year that this Parliament was created. And this isn't a criticism of Blairism or the Labour Party, it's just, I think, an interesting quote for context, because he said, in future, welfare will be a hand up and not a hand out. And actually, I think that appeasement of the critics of social security at that time, and that appeasement lasted for several years into the early part of this century, was a mistake as well as the criticism. And we're all collectively as a society responsible for that. We challenged, many of us challenged, but we obviously didn't challenge enough, because we need to be open and move forward in a position that there is nothing wrong with either handouts or hands ups, because we want to do what we need to do to help those to contribute and realise their potential as much as possible. So it's about busting the myths, because not everyone can work, and not all work, as we know, pays enough to live well. So that is where we need social security and to value social security. And I think Emma Roddick made such an important point. In fact, she made several really important points. But one of the things that really stuck out for me was that she said, this is about how we create a fairer and caring society. And that's where the emphasis and the focus needs to be. And I remember when the 2018 Social Security Act was passed and Jean Freeman was sitting there and I was sitting there, it was a defining moment and a shift for this Parliament, but also the start of how we together shift consciousness across the wider country. And that's what this benefit take-up strategy is about for us as a government in terms of what the Act stipulates us to do, but also to give us focus to work with partners and to create that sense of collaboration more widely within society to make the difference and to help the people that we all want to achieve. So to come on to some of the points that were raised in the debate in that spirit of collective engagement, I note the points that Miles Briggs made around the Young Carer Grant, and I'd like to engage with him on that and on the recent activity. He talked about evaluation of the Charter, and just for his awareness, the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland take monitoring of our commitments under the Charter extremely seriously. We have already published two editions of the Charter Measurement Framework, which reports on the progress that we are making, and indeed the 2020-21 report was released yesterday. So I look forward to engaging with Mr Briggs on that going forward. I thought Alexander Stewart also made some very constructive points, which I welcome and look forward to continuing to work with him. Unfortunately, I wanted to be really consensual at the end of this debate, Presiding Officer, but I did find both Sharon Dowie and Jeremy Balfour's comments unnecessarily negative. I think their Prime Minister would call them doomsters and gloomsters, because they just really did not get into the spirit of what today's debate is about and about what the benefit take-up strategy is focused on. Because you know, there were some significant inaccuracies as well, or some mischaracterisations. For example, the annual report that Social Security Scotland issued this week reported a 90% plus satisfaction rate with engagement with the agency. The local development teams have been operating in the pilot areas, so aren't fully stood up in all the different local authorities. And
You know, both Sharon Dewey and Jeremy Balfour made critical points around the Scottish Child Payment, which of course is an innovative creation of the Scottish Government, but has also helped 108,000 children. You know, that's a positive to celebrate and engage on, and we should have come to this debate, I think, in the spirit of that recognition and determination to do more together. Yes. Moving back to the benefits take-up policy of where our focus is, I think it's important to just re-emphasise some of what the Cabinet Secretary said about the fact that we will launch a £20.4 million independent advocacy service, that we're investing £10 million over the current Parliament to increase access to welfare advice in accessible settings to maximise incomes and tackle poverty. And I think of the people that I've met in different parts of the country who've talked about how they've heard about Social Security Scotland benefits when they were in the school setting or at an organisation like a care support network, for example. So these are really important investments that will increase take-up. And also, the full rollout of Social Security's local delivery network will be significant, and there will be 400 staff in 32 local authorities by the time the service is fully operational. And just to state as well that we will continue, of course, to work with third sector organisations and charities proactively and in an engaged way, and recognise all the contributions that such organisations have submitted ahead of today's debate. Also, importantly, is the work of engaging with seldom heard groups to better understand and address non-take-up among particular populations. And I think Paul O'Kane emphasised that point quite rightly. And we are very focused on that in the strategy and will be going forward. And of course, it's important that we have rightly made our engagement as inclusive as we can, with materials proactively produced in an easy read format, the use of different languages in what we're producing, of course, and British Sign Language, and more than 100 languages available on request, including Braille. So a really focused agenda on inclusivity and engagement. And that takes me on to some points I just want to address more broadly that have been raised in the debate. And that's around the delivery. So I appreciate that the focus has been on the benefit take-up strategy, but I just want to touch on some of the delivery questions that have been raised. First of all, the point about build is so important. We're building a new institution here in Scotland that we want to be strong in the here and now, to deliver in the period ahead, and then also to be robust, agile, and effective for decades to come. And that's why the importance of what's been done in the years that we've lived through and since 2018 and the period ahead is so important, because we want to create that strength, that agility, and also the IT infrastructure to be able to do things, for example, in a more automated way, as Paul O'Kane and Maggie Chapman rightly emphasised. But also, yes, sure.
Thank the Minister for taking this intervention, because I think one of the concerns is still around who's going to be delivering some of this potential work, and especially with regards to assessments. We know the delays which currently exist with GPs, for example, providing that. So I just wondered, in terms of that work, the workforce which is expected to undertake assessments or to do provide evidential documentation around people's conditions, where the government were with that work programme.
Minister.
I think Miles Briggs raises an important point. I would state to him that our engagement with the medical profession and with health boards on that aspect of the delivery programme, I had an engagement and an update on that this week, and we're encouraged about how positive it's progressing, and I'd be happy to keep in touch with Miles Briggs and Parliament more widely on the importance of those points. So I want to get to some of the points that for example, Willie Rennie raised, because first of all, he talked really importantly about the position around lifetime awards, and I just want to make it very clear to him that this is something that is, of course, very important to us in government as well, and that work is underway to establish the parameters for provision of indefinite awards for clients whose needs are very unlikely to change. And we are committed to building a person-centred social security system based on the principles of fairness, dignity and respect, and reducing the number of unnecessary reviews, which of course are a source of stress and anxiety for some clients in the current system. So we are committed to it, and I'm happy to keep them updated. Sure.
Mr. Balfour.
I really welcome that comment by the Minister, but my reading, and perhaps she could clarify, but my reading of the regulations are at the moment that even if I can be personal, someone like my condition would still have to come back every 10 years to be assessed. So why are we still asking people who have lifelong conditions to keep coming back? We're not getting rid of that, we're just making it a slightly longer period.
Minister, and if you could bring your remarks towards a conclusion, that would be
sure. I would just refer Mr. Balfour to my last answer, that it's something that we are currently working on in terms of the parameters for provision of indefinite awards, and happy to keep Parliament updated. In terms of considerations around the 20-metre rule that was raised, I think it's important to emphasise that, you know, we are making changes to the delivery of disability assistance, which will significantly improve the experience of disabled people what they have when they're accessing payments. And we are confident that these changes, such as replacing assessments with person-centred consultations, will address concerns around how the criteria are applied and how decisions on mobility are made. And I would refer members to the answer to a PQ that I gave to Pam Duncan-Glancy at S6W02508. And I'd be happy to take correspondence from any members on that. And the Cabinet Secretary has stated SCOSI's position. But all of this orientates around the fact that we are simultaneously with this new agency building. We are creating the new benefits and the replacement benefits, and then we're also transferring. And of course, that transfer initiated last month, and it is one of the biggest transfers in the history of the UK state. So I think it's important to remember the sheer size of what we're doing here. And we have made changes. We've made changes to terminal illness. We've made changes to the support for carers. And, of course, the seven new benefits that I mentioned. And, yes, I am happy to record our thanks to DWP for the engagement and collaboration that we've had with their officials. And I'm glad that our officials are working well. And, you know, on questions around the eligibility criteria and passporting, the Cabinet Secretary and I had a meeting with UK ministers this week on that very point, and seek to have as constructive engagement as possible with UK government. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, it's important to refer back to the benefit take-up strategy and the wider question of how do we collectively do as much as possible to make sure that Social Security Scotland is making a bigger difference as possible throughout our society. This is about looking forward, not back, not blaming others, but working as Team Scotland. So despite some of the negative comments that have been made today, my appeal is that all of us commit and recommit to getting behind the project of Social Security Scotland, to being positive about what it's doing, to be realistic about what it can achieve, and to be ambitious about where we want it to go. We are committed to that. The benefit take-up strategy sets out how we can engage citizens in that work. And collectively, and all MSPs can play a part in this, let's make sure that today, although we're not voting, we're committed to doing all that we can to helping those in the communities all across Scotland to access the support that they are entitled to, that they deserve, and that we want them to have. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate on accessing Scottish social security benefits, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business. The next item of business is consideration of a business motion 1986 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out changes to next week's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now, and I call on the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion. Can I ask you, Minister, if you would attempt to move the motion again? If I could ask Gillian Mackay to move the motion.
I will not do as good a job as the Minister of Parliamentary Business, but move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed. And you managed to do it with much less of a stern stare, I have to say. No member, thankfully, is asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 1986 is agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Excellent. The next item of business is consideration of parliamentary motion 1987 on approval of an SSSI. And I ask George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move the motion.
Officer.
Welcome back, Minister. The question on this motion will now be put at decision time, to which we now seamlessly move, thanks to the valiant efforts of the Minister in the last debate. There is only one question to be put as a result of today's business. The question is that motion 1987, in the name of George Adam, on approval of an SSI, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Excellent. The motion is therefore agreed, and that concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.